No, there's no thanks needed. Go back to what you said, though, for like a mental part of it, in all aspects of the game as well. No, you do some stuff outside of hockey too, but it's such a, I think it's like the most major factor in anything. I mean, sure, you can, a lot of guys can get in the same kind of shape, the same kind of strength and talent and stuff like that, but there's something that always separates those, separates the level of players, and it's how they approach the game, the mental side they get to. They get to preparing for games.
That was Stanley Cup champion and NHL enforcer Eric Godard, and you are listening to the Up My Hockey Podcast with Jason Podolin. Just watch me now. Welcome to Up My Hockey with Jason Podolin, where we deconstruct the NHL journey, discuss what it takes to make it, and have a few laughs along the way. I'm your host, Jason Podolin, a 31st overall draft pick who played 41 NHL games but thought he was destined for 1,000. Learn from my story and those of my guests. This is a hockey podcast about reaching your potential. Hello there. Welcome back to the Up My Hockey Podcast with Jason Podolin. I am Jason Podolin, your host. And today we have episode 89. And for episode 89... I am sticking local to the Vernon, British Columbia, Canada area, to a guy that was actually so local that he was my next door neighbor up here at Predator Ridge in Vernon, BC, a fellow Vernon minor hockey product, although he's a few years younger than me, and that's Eric Godard, as you heard in the intro. Eric and I were teammates for the Bridgeport Sound Tigers way back in, what year was that? Way back in 2001, 2002. Eric had yet to play any NHL games at that point. It was one of his first years, if not his first year pro. And we ended up going to an AHL final together that year, which we talk about in the podcast. And Eric went on to play games for the New York Islanders. He went on to play games for the Calgary Flames. And he went on to play a lot of games for the Pittsburgh Penguins, where he also won a Stanley Cup in 2009, playing with Sidney Crosby, Malkin, Billy Guerin, Marc-Andre Fleury, you know, who, like, obviously that team was amazing, and Eric was a big part of that run up to the Cup and even in the Cup itself. So what an amazing thing to have in your resume as a hockey player to accomplish that. And we talk about kind of the fun that we had. I was able to go out on the boat with him when he had his Cup for the day, and my oldest son, Hudson, shout out to Hudson, my 2009 born Hudson. He couldn't have been born in a better year being Eric Godard's neighbor. Hudson was born July 15th. Eric had the Cup, I think, towards the end of August. But I think Hudson was about 5 weeks old, and we went over on his deck and for the morning breakfast, and people were eating cereal out of it and what have you. And we cleaned out the Cup, and Hudson, it was time for his early morning nap. And Hudson actually slept in the Stanley Cup, and we have some great pictures to prove it. So what a great memory for my oldest son, and great memories for my wife and I too, who got to spend some time with Eric that day on the Cup. But yeah, Eric was a feared tough guy. I mean, there's been a few players interviewed on other podcasts that have mentioned Eric as the toughest of his era, or one of the most feared of his era. There wasn't many guys, well, no one that he backed down to, and no one that really had his number. He did mention off the air afterwards that Colton Orr was somebody that gave him a really hard time throughout his career. He mentioned that George Larocque was probably the strongest guy that he ever fought, although never really got in any trouble against him. But he did say that Colton got him. But other than that, you know, we didn't cover it in the interview, but I mean, Bugard played for Minnesota at the time, and Eric, as at a time when Bugard was running rampant throughout the NHL, felt to be one of the toughest guys. Eric brought him to his knees and legitimately knocked him down in Calgary, and that went through the league like wildfire. And I think that was probably a big reason why Pittsburgh ended up picking him up in that offseason to help their squad and to protect their star players. So Eric represents a time in hockey. Ice Guardians was a film that Eric was a part of. A time in hockey that doesn't really exist anymore. You know, a role, Eric filled a role that doesn't exist anymore. And unfortunately now, because I'm doing this intro after I've had the conversation, that's how I always do it. I regret not talking about that, you know, Eric got to the NHL. He was kind of one of those unsuspecting guys. He never thought that he would play in the NHL. He never thought he was going to play junior, as we talk about in the conversation. He never thought he was going to play pro at the AHL level, as we mentioned in the conversation. And he was, you know, once he got to pro, he thought maybe this could happen, but he never really believed he was going to be in the NHL. And that career path just doesn't exist anymore. And I'd love to know what he thinks about that, if the game's in a better place. I think at some point it's going to swing back a little bit, maybe not to the exact time when Eric was playing, where there was just, you know, a 5 minute a night kind of tough guy role player that would sit on the bench. But I do think that there's going to be more and more kind of Ryan Reeves, more and more of the Tom Wilson types in the game, and some of these defensemen that can protect teammates and are willing to throw some knuckles from time to time. But by all accounts, Eric served a role on the teams that he was on, and a very, very valuable one at that, and was one of the beloved teammates for the places he played. And I think that comes through pretty loud and clear in this interview. Eric will self-admittedly say that he's not somebody that's going to necessarily carry a conversation, but he was a quiet guy in the locker room, but a super nice, authentically, genuinely friendly guy. And I think that comes through loud and clear here in this interview, and I'm really thankful he was able to spend almost 90 minutes with us today. Eric is also a scout now for the Minnesota Wild, which we get into at the end of the interview. Lots of good stories here. We have some good laughs. We were able to catch up and reminisce, and we were also able to realize what we both love about what we do, and that's the aspect that there is a team aspect of feeling to it. You know, me with the podcast, of being able to connect, reconnect with these players, that these humans that I used to play with, that we used to have this brotherhood with, and to share these stories really invigorates me and enlivens me and leaves me on a high for the rest of the day. And he said that, you know, since he's been back working with the Minnesota Wild and a part of a team, the scouting team that relies on one each other and has this kind of inner circle, that he really, really feels connected again to the sport and really loves what he does. So excellent advice there. Maybe we'll start off with that lesson, because that was one of the big lessons I took away from this discussion, was really appreciate what you do. For those of you who are playing hockey, some of you younger players that are listening right now, and you have this band of brothers that you're playing with, or if it's a young lady listening, you have this band of sisters that you're playing with, like, do not take that for granted. It is such a special thing to be a part of a team, to be pulling for each other, to be rooting for each other, to have those connections on a daily basis. It's one of the most special things about the game that you're going to get, and they last a long, long time if you treat them with the respect that they deserve. So on that note, let's get right into the interview with Stanley Cup champion, Mr. Eric Goddard. All right, here we are for the Out My Hockey Podcast episode. Geez, I think it's 88 or 89, Godsey. I'm almost hitting the century mark, but welcome to the podcast. I know we've just been talking off camera that I've been talking to you about doing this for a long time now, and it's finally happening. So thanks so much for being here.
No problem. 89 is it's getting up there, like you, I guess. Eh?
It's crazy. It's crazy how that happens. Century mark, like, I can almost call myself a podcaster at that point, can't I?
Yeah. I think you can do it now.
Okay. I'll just take that now. I'll run with that. Yeah, man, I think there's going to be so much fun stuff to talk about, just because of all the guests. I mean, a majority of the guests I've played with, and we checked that box as well, but not all of my guests have been my neighbor. So that's a little different. And not all of my guests have been my neighbor that actually had the Stanley Cup visit while they stayed there. So that's pretty cool to talk about. And not all of my guests have been super, super tough guys at the NHL level. So that's also cool to talk about. So I know we got a lot to go on, but I usually like to start, buddy, with like how it all started. And because everyone's path is so different, and I think yours is pretty unique in its own right, how we ended up becoming a pro hockey player and how you ended up getting to the NHL and fellow Vernon Minor hockey product. So why don't we take it back to like when you
you fell in love with it, and what age do you remember falling in love with it?
I think it's most like everybody else. You just kind of always had fun. You got your good group of guys. I don't know. I feel lucky up here in Vernon. Like, been lifelong friends that I've grown up with. Getting to play with them, and as it kind of got older, starting to get more competitive, that's when it kind of really, really started to love it.
When did that come? When did that start happening? Like, what age was it? Was it getting competitive?
Well, actually, I remember first year of Pee Wee. We went to the provincials and stuff like that. Lost in a heartbreaking overtime. That was a tough one. We had everybody played two games a day, and ours happened on like the last day, and so then we ended up going to playoffs in the finals. I don't know. We played three games that day and lost in overtime.
In the
finals. It was upsetting. Yeah, in the finals. It was upsetting, as I can still feel that right still.
Isn't that wild, though? Like, I know, like, you're saying that tongue-in-cheek, but it is real. Like, you actually do remember it, and you actually was heartbreaking.
Oh, totally. Yeah, I still picture this one kid's face. He had, like, the trophy. They're skating around like everyone does. He does, like, the big knee bend. And he looks, like, straight at me as he's, like, pumping it in the air. Oh, God, I wish I could see that kid nowadays. I can't get his face out of my skull.
That's one of the things, like, I've mentioned it on this show before, I think. You know, you went on to win a Stanley Cup, right? So, there's nothing grander than that in sports. And I'm going to relay, like, my career, winning, like, and I'm going to rub a little salt in your wound here. We happened to win the Pee Wee Championship in provincials from Vernon the year we were there. And it, like, what were we, 13 years old? And, again, yeah. Like, to your point, all the guys in that team, almost all of them, I still know in some capacity. A majority of them are still like good buddies of mine. And it was for sure one of the highlights of my entire career of hockey. Like top three, guaranteed, right? Like winning a Pee Wee Provincial Championship. So it can totally impact you, like youth sports. On the positive and on the negative side too. But that's wild. I didn't know you guys got to the provincials as well. Wow. Who was on that team? Any names? Did anyone else go play anywhere, university or otherwise?
Well, yeah, it was Chris Ovington. You know, whole career, like Reed Litster, Corey Hintz. Yeah, a lot of names you could probably list off.
So some guys that went on to play WHL for sure, right? From a Vernon Pee Wee team, which doesn't happen all the time. So you guys had a pretty strong crew.
Yeah, it was a good team. It was fun.
That is cool. So what was your journey like to the WHL? Did you get the Bantam draft existed when you were around? Did you get drafted in the draft?
No, nothing like that. I was just almost kind of went through Bantam and then played midget. And I was in my last year midget, kind of things just kind of came together. I had a really good year. Was actually scoring goals, which was something that's, feels like a one-year kind of wonder by now. Since then, I didn't put up much. And got just like, what did you call it when you went to, I got put on their list or something like that, and then I got to play a couple games at the end of that year and just did kind of well. Just had that last year. Maybe I kind of filled out into my body, got more comfortable with skating, and just had a good year, and kind of everything kind of took off from there.
Right. So you got scouted at the midget level by the Hurricanes, and they threw you on the list and they invited you up to go play some games.
Yep. Velo Fernan guy, Craig Dimitrik, kind of got it all started.
Sweet. And so interesting. Like, can you walk us through that a little bit? So, I mean, you're playing hockey because you like it at that point. Like, you didn't really have, maybe you had aspirations, but no one was really telling you, hey, man, you're going to be playing in the dub one day. You're going to be playing in the NHL. You were just kind of doing your thing by the sounds of it, right? And then all of a sudden the Hurricanes came knocking. What was that like when all of a sudden you're getting this attention?
It was really kind of strange. I mean, because that kind of happened, and then the Hurricanes came through town. And they're like, well, why don't you come play a game for us in Kamloops? And I was like, this isn't happening. This is kind of... I was like, I'm not supposed to be doing this. But that was kind of yeah, kind of something that happened just out of the blue. I remember going up there, I had these old beat up skates too, a big hole in the toe. They're like, you can't wear those in this league. Here, we got to get you some skates. So they took me to some sports shop. And I'm like getting these new pairs of skates. I'm like, this can't be real. And you know, like brand new skates, you put them on. I was toe picking everywhere. My first shift, I was driving the net, toe pick, just basically ran the goalie. I'm like, I wonder if the goalies, if the guys are kind of hitting me after that. I'm like, I have no, like, just no clue what's going on. I'm like, just try and work hard, not fall down, and get this game over with. This is a terrible start to it.
Oh my God, God, dude, that is such an epic story. So you get drug out of Vernon Midget to go play in the WHL against the Blazers, and they decide to buy you new skates because yours aren't quite high enough quality for the league.
No. I don't think it could have went worse.
Yeah, like, I mean, most of the listeners are hockey players or have played hockey, but I mean, I think for those who haven't played, like, that is a death sentence. To put on new skates like without skating on them before a game is absolute death sentence. So that's hilarious that they even asked you to do that. My God.
Oh, yeah, it's funny. I can't imagine the other guys in the room, like, no one's saying anything. I'm going up, I'm warm up, falling down. They're like, can't even skate.
Oh my gosh, that is wild. That is so wild. You know what, that's actually, maybe I should tell this Danny Markov story just quick, because it just comes to mind. We were roommates. We were in where the hell was that, some little town, doesn't matter, on the East Coast or somewhere, playing in the A on a road trip, and Danny gets called up from St. John Flames, right? He's going to go to Toronto the next day. And Danny Markov, for anyone who knows him at all, knows he didn't mind a cigarette, and he definitely didn't mind a beer. And he did not give a rip that he was getting called. He'd never been in the NHL before, never been called up. He was the last one to leave the bar that night. Like, I was his roommate, and I was home in bed asleep, right? And he was supposed to be on a plane at 6 a.m. the next day.
Oh, he knew about it?
Yeah, and he knew about it. They told him before he left the arena. And so he ends up coming back because he had to pack, you know, we packed our own stuff or whatever. He was going to be on the early flight, and he forgot his skates, right? So he forgot his skates. So he had to leave without his skates. So Toronto got him new skates. And I guess the way Danny, like, broke in new skates was that he didn't do them up. So he's in the NHL for pregame skate with brand new skates on that he hasn't tied up, smelling like a chimney in a booze factory. And he never played another game in the AHL. Like, he was never back again. Like, I that story still blows my mind. Can you imagine, right, being in the show and this young Russian comes up with new skates that aren't done up?
No, unreal.
Oh, my God, that story cracks me up. But we got to get back to yours. So, okay, so then this is super interesting because in midget, no one's fighting in midget, and you're scoring goals, you said. So, like, you've had a career year for you. You're feeling good. They call you up. They can't assume that you're a fighter, like, right? They probably just wanted you to come play. Is that accurate?
Yeah, I think that's kind of fair to say. I don't know. I don't imagine they would, because there's no fighting there. I remember going to a couple, like, BCHL camp, trying to fight there, and just got my face pumped. I went there, had a game. I think I just kind of naturally got in a fight.
In Kamloops?
Not in Kamloops, no. When I got, sorry, I finished off midget, and then I went up to Lethbridge after the year was over and played, first game there, maybe second game, kind of got in a fight. I was like, I don't know. I remember watching Rock'em Sock'em Hockey and trying to get in. Did okay. I think I had a couple good shifts where I was maybe still had the confidence from the midget year, and got in a fight, and it was kind of, the rest kind of went from there. I remember I had this big tryout in rugby that I was going to go to, but I talked to the coach there, Maxwell, and he's like, well, I can see you maybe playing pro hockey. And I don't know, my jaw must have dropped, because I'd never heard anything close to that. I was more confused than anything. So I'm like, I don't know, talk to my parents and, like, well, maybe stick around and see where this goes. And kind of went from there. Had finished the rest of the year off there, and then went to camp the next year and Played the next 2 years.
I mean, I got your stats here up. So you had 7 games that first year, like where they grabbed you out of midget, and 26 PIMs. But at that point, you'd had the one fight in BCJ, but you weren't a fighter, or didn't know you were a fighter at that point, or that you were even any good at it.
Yeah, not really. Just kind of went, I don't know, kind of in some small way, knew that it would kind of, because you know, it was part of the game and stuff like that. Well, maybe I can do this and it'll help me stick around,
right?
More or less, and just kind of adjusted and kind of fell into that role. And I was lucky early on enough that be like, I'm not going to make this on really skill alone. So just kind of took that approach to it and kind of just fight my way there.
Right, right. And you mentioned Maxie, and I totally forgot that. Or Maxwell, you said, and you had the same coach I had in junior for the majority of my junior career, Brian Maxwell. And Brian Maxwell, for those that don't know, was a, I think he was 5th overall or something, NHL draft pick, and played many, many years in the NHL, mm-hmm. but was a very physical stay-at-home defenseman. And is it fair to say he was pretty old school, Guzzi?
Oh, yeah. He was intense. Really good coach, demanded lots of you, but he was always fair, too. I mean, he was just, man, talk about a guy like to smoke too.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was joking about beer. I mean, I won't get into all that, but you mean definitely. Yeah. Right. And some of the stuff that he pulled, like you couldn't do now. You know, I mean, that was just the way it was, but I agree with you. Mm-hmm. He was an intimidating guy, wasn't he?
Oh yeah. Just that the way he looked, the way he talked too, just like this, I don't know. He just had one of those presence, like you said, like the old school kind of guy.
Yeah, he had a voice like a bear, and you know, he had just big paws on him. He'd shake his hand. He had these big oven mitts that he would be lugging around. And why it's interesting to talk those, mm-hmm. because like I saw him, and I think Soizy would agree with this. I saw him essentially create Kevin Sawyer. Like I saw, you know, he helped Brian McCabe figure out that aspect of the game. Like he definitely helped the edgy players become good at what they do. And like he taught Kevin Sawyer like the art, the skill of fighting, right? Like with the holds and how to do it. And I remember them wrestling after practice and him showing him all this stuff. And is that what he did? Did he kind of help you? Did he mentor you with that role at all?
Sort of a little bit. He gave me kind of opportunities and stuff like that, and he would kind of help me. Not so much about the fighting, but how to play that role and be kind of, I don't know, play on the edge. What's so? I remember skating around one practice, and he was screwing around, hit me, and then I kind of made some comment about calling him old or something like that. And he just had that, looked like the switch went off and his like, I'm like, oh God, just petrified. It must have looked like just a deer in headlights. I was like, oh my God, sorry. I'm so sorry. I think I ended up apologizing to him like on the bus after practice or when we were on the road or something like that. And he was just kind of giving me a hard time. And he's one of those things like, yeah, you got to be able to turn it on at a second's notice. And I kind of at a second's notice, and I kind of just never forgot that.
Right. He had that switch.
Yeah.
This, I mean, and I'm not telling the story to get him in trouble because it doesn't even matter and it doesn't affect me at the time, but it was a pretty impactful moment. But I saw that switch once. More than once, but with me personally, I think the biggest impact one was we were getting ready before a game. It was in the old Boone Street Barn, which I don't think you probably ever had a chance to play in. It was previous to the Spokane Coliseum, that big, beautiful rink that they have now there in Spokane. And Boone Street Barn had a ton of character in it, right? It was, you know, if you look down the boards, you know, like there's like a snake like this, right? You know, and if any type of hit, the boards would sway, and it was a huge crash. And our dressing room was up on the second floor, and we had to walk down kind of through the crowd to get to the ice. And there was definitely a lot of, it was just a really cool place to play. But anyways, regardless of that, we're up in the restroom, and we're getting ready for this game, and and Maxi, as you know, he liked his entrance, right? He'd come in at about the 5 minute mark, I think it was. And like, and it was always the 5 minute mark, right? Like whatever it was, when that clock was there, he'd walk in and he expected everyone to be in their seat. And I knew this, but I also had to take a huge piss, right? Like I always before the game, right? Like I would have this, I'd have a nervous piss, right? And I was like, well, either I do it now and try and get back to my seat before Maxi comes, right? Or I'm going to have to piss myself on the bench, right? So I run off to the can and I'm coming back. And sure enough, I'm coming back into the room, like as he's walking into the room, right? And I think I was 16 or 17 too, like, you know, young and new to the league. And he gave me that, like, he walked in and he gave me that, you know, like that look. And I was like, yeah. and during the talk, he kept like looking back, you know, like, and then he stopped at one point and he goes, "Put on, what is that?" You know, and I was like, "Nervous piss, Maxi. Don't you nervous piss me," he says, right? Like, and then I'm like, oh my God, right? I'm just like losing it. And I was always like second last one out of the room. So now I'm like, do I go first? Because I think I'm going to get murdered, you know, or do I wait? And, anyway, so I waited and it was by the stick rack. And anyway, Sawyer was the last one to go out all the time. So it was Sawyer and me. And Maxi came over and like, I don't remember what he said, but he legitimately grabbed me by the neck and like had me up against the wall. And he was like looking at me. And it was like those, like, I think he might've maybe murdered me, maybe if Soizy wasn't there. Right. Like Soizy and Soizy said something to him and he kind of like clicked back in. And then nothing happened after that, but like, oh my God, like, you know, obviously he should have never have done that. You know what I mean? But times were different. And it is what it is. And he never hurt me and I'm fine. And it's a funny story to tell now, although I think that's the first time I've ever told that story. But you talking about that switch, I saw the fear of God. Like when that switch went, I was like, oh, this is not going to be good. Yeah. Not going to be good. But to your point, man, like he taught me more about the game than I think any other coach did.
Yeah. I'd say so too. He was so great at doing that. I mean, you talk about maybe he can't do that anymore. I mean, obviously grabbing it, but just, I don't know, just how he approached the game and would be very open with me about it. Like, hey, this could be a way to go. He's like, I did it. Would help me kind of prepare for games and stuff like that. He was unbelievable how he would teach me how to kind of study the game or find players to kind of to watch to be like, and it was great. I'd love to have him as a coach again.
Yeah, I agree. He always talked to, I remember the guys, I think that's why, I mean, I don't think he disliked me, but we were definitely different players, right? Like I played competitive and I had no issue fighting, but like before a game, like for me to be like mad before the game started, that just wasn't me. And I didn't play well that way. You know, I couldn't be too serious. I had to be a little more loose and that wasn't him. Right. But the guys that he gravitated to, and I think that really, really did well underneath him were like Kaber. And he taught Kaber how to play with a burr, as Maxi would call a burr up his ass. Right. Like I'm sure he used that phrase with you a ton. Right. Like, and he talked about preparing. So you're mad before things even started. So you don't play your way into it, right? Like you're already in this mindset of it's wartime, essentially, right? I don't know if he worked with you on that, but I told, like, Jeremy Stasiak was another one. He was my line mate. Like he totally, Jimmy would play unbelievable when he was ready like that, you know, and for his style of game. Brian McCabe, Kevin Sawyer, Paxton Schulte. Like I can go on and on, like these guys that he brought out the best in those players by talking them through that type of preparation status. And I talked to some of the guys I work with now on that too. Some guys play like they're better hockey players playing a little bit angry. Right.
I think so too. Yeah. Just coming out, being ready to play from the drop of the puck and how important it was to play like that full 60 minutes. I mean, not kind of waiting, I don't know, taking the initiative more and pushing the pace of the game. Instead of just kind of waiting for it to come to us.
Yeah, I know for sure. As you grew into that role, like how were you somebody? I mean, I don't know how your memory is with everything, but like my memory is definitely not great. Like as far as much, you mean, I remember some big events, I remember things, but I'm not super clear on a lot of stuff. And I don't remember what you were like in the room before games is why I'm saying that. Like, were you somebody that was, pretty, I mean, you're a pretty quiet guy just by your natural personality. I assume you would have been more keep to yourself, more more kind of from that serious get pissed off before it starts mode?
Yeah, I was never the big talk or anything like that. I was more kind of quiet and trying to get myself ready to come out. I just always felt more comfortable and felt that I would play a lot better if I just kind of would kind of focus on my game and whatnot, not trying to pump other guys up too much.
Right. What, I've never, I'm sure you've probably been asked this question before, although you mean I haven't asked it much before. So why I'm still curious with it is when it comes to you and your approach to, you know, your role, I guess, at the NHL level, which was to take on some pretty tough characters for the most part. Was that something that you looked forward to, or was it something that you like, what was your whole approach to what you did? Was it with a bit of a smile, or was it with a little bit of fear, or like, I don't know what the right word is, but can you walk us through what that was?
I've always felt like kind of different from game to game. I mean, I'd say the majority of the time was like pretty that like nervous kind of energy, whatnot. Some games it would be just almost felt like terrified with that big like anxiety kind of coming out. Some nights maybe you just knew it was coming and you just had that exciting kind of, you know, just happy to be in that moment kind of thing. Like it was okay, it was fun, it's gonna be a fun night because you know the game that's gonna come and it's just everyone's just kind of all ramped up for it. But definitely sometimes, maybe the majority of the times, was just that nervous energy coming out because, you know, God, you know, you see these guys fight now with all the clips and internet, you can see the guys fight when they're almost like the beginning of junior. So it was, you kind of always knew the guys coming up, and a lot of the guys came out of the Western League just at that same kind of time. So I kind of already fought them and stuff like that. And it was, yeah, I guess, long story short, it was majority of it just being nervous.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and you know me, right, with my questions and what I'm into. Like, I think the psychology of that, I mean, there's obviously a massively physical component to do what you guys did. You know, like, most of you guys were monsters, super strong, really, really, really powerful and skilled at what you guys did, yet there's a psychological component there that I think for people who to disregard it is not doing it any type of justice. Because, you know, when I have had the conversations, it's like not many of you guys were like smiling going into it. You know, maybe, you know, there's a handful, right, that actually enjoyed it. A lot of guys, I mean, it was a job, right? And it was something that brought out some anxiety, and it wasn't something that was, you know, fun, let's say. And I just had tremendous amount of respect for you guys that were able to do that night in and night out. My goodness. So first of all, thank you for what you did. I'm not sure if you ever got enough of that. I know at the time I would definitely be giving pad stabs, and I think that guys, you know, I think you guys appreciated it, but I'm not sure if it was ever like a grateful, heartfelt thanks, because you know, sometimes you kept me out of some trouble. I know that for sure by having your presence around.
Oh, you're always stirring up stuff. No, there's no thanks needed. Go back to what you said, though, for like a mental part of it, in all aspects of the game as well. No, you do some stuff outside of hockey, too, but it's such a, I don't know, I think it's like the most major factor in anything. I mean, sure, a lot of guys can get in the same kind of shape, the same kind of strength and talent and stuff like that, but there's something that always separates the level of players, and it's how they approach the game, the mental side they get to preparing for games off the ice, doing the extra little things to make sure they're one step ahead. I mean, it's just it's a huge thing. I mean, when it came to like my role and stuff like that, I mean, there was always kind of like a balance that I always had struggled with finding. I mean, sometimes I'd get so worked up and ready to just kind of be ready to fight the other guy or in that kind of role. And I always felt my game would kind of suffer because I wouldn't be necessarily prepared for the game. I'd just go out and skate around looking for a fight, basically, instead of just kind of settling into the kind of the role in case something happens. then other times I would just get prepared to play the game, and my game was better. I played better, but then I'd come to some fight, and it's like I didn't have like a that kind of edge. I was more, I don't know, taking the cautious approach to the fight, which doesn't really, I never thought did it myself any favor. I didn't, I'd kind of lose those fights, and that's something I'd worry about, because if I lose the fight, their team's getting excited. My team's getting taken down a lot. You know, there's kind of that pride and that worry that, you know, I got to win this fight for the team to keep this game and this battle rolling, basically. Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess the next level of that is, too, you lose too many fights and you lose your job.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Well, right, you know what I mean? Like, when it comes down to it, right? I mean, like that and that's never a great spot to operate from. But I guess, I mean, in our own way, we sort of all, I mean, I stop scoring goals and I'm not going to be a goal scorer anymore. And I lose my job too, I guess. Right. So I guess it's sort of the same. You got to do what you're there to do. But I totally understand that too. Cause when you're saying like play my game, like part of your game is being physical and getting into a fight and doing well there, but you're also playing the game of hockey. Right. So I totally see what you're saying there. Cause you're playing a game within a game. Really?
I'm sort of, but I mean, it's all kind of relatable as well. I mean, you're talking about like going scoring and stuff like that. You kind of, I've seen some guys, they're there to score, they're putting up goals, and there's always those kind of slumps, you know, like fighting almost kind of like maybe you'll get a little break because there's at least you're going out there and trying. But it's got to be tough to go in like some of those little, what do you call it, slumps. I've seen some guys like really start to kind of affect them, then they're kind of like changing sticks, changing tapes, you know, like, dude, I'm like, man, that's I'm glad I don't have to go do that.
I was that guy for sure.
Yeah.
Super streaky. Try and help players now.
It's hard though. Like, yeah, it's like, I mean, that's got to take like a mental toll.
Just going to take a short break from my discussion with Eric Goddard to remind you all about upmyhockey.com, the website, which is the business behind the podcast. So the business behind the podcast is getting people what they want, getting hockey players what they want, which means their goals, which means their dreams, which means becoming the best player that they can be. I believe the key to development is between your ears. I believe it's mindset, and I believe it's the approach to the game, whether that is managing emotions, creating confidence, keeping confidence, or whether that be your approach to practice and your approach to development, your personal practice, as I call it, or whether that be means covering your belief system and your mindset about development and growth and progress and what mistakes mean. And what feedback means, or whether that means just really clearly understanding what your controllables are as an athlete, what is within your control and what is with not, and becoming a master at the ones that are within your control, whether it be preparation or nutrition or sleep or your thoughts or your practice habits or your inner circle. There are so many things that fall within the realm of mindset, as I call it. I think that is the thing that separates us from the rest, from the pack. Allows you to develop faster, allows you to have a longer shelf life, a longer career, gives you more opportunities, and it really taps into the potential that is within each and every one of us. I love mentoring players in that regard. I do it on a one-on-one level. I do it at a team level. The foundation that I work with players on is through the Peak Potential Hockey Project, which is a four-week program I developed that has four different themes throughout the week, some of which I just touched on. And that is what I do when it comes to working with players across North America. That is my approach. That is the competitive advantage. And these are the skills that are going to last your player a lifetime, not just within hockey, but in whatever it is that they choose to do. I also have my on-ice programs and camps that I run here locally. That is another part of the Up My Hockey business. But for all intents and purposes, this podcast exists because of the mindset work that I do with athletes. It gives me a platform to talk about things that I think are super relevant, that I think allow athletes to change their perspective,
to make different choices about how they're going to participate in their games and in their practice and how they're going to choose to spend their time. And I'm grateful for the opportunity that it gives to have these powerful conversations with very, very successful people and with successful players. So if you are interested as either a parent or a hockey player about working and developing your mindset, which is probably the thing that you have never contemplated actually consciously working on with some intention, then Up My Hockey is the place for you to start. The Peak Potential Hockey Project is a place for you to look at. You can do that on an individual level, or you can do that as a team. There's two ways to do that. The team aspect is something that I'm very busy with this fall. There's been a lot of teams approaching me. I do have room for more. If this is something that you want to do as a team, if you're a general manager, a hockey parent, or a coach, and you want to have this become part of the curriculum for your team this year and make it a year to remember, by all means, reach out to me on upmyhockey.com. I can get you all the details. There is also upmyhockey.com/peak potential. It's really easy to find on the website. That gives you all the information about the Peak Potential Hockey Project and why it might be something you'd want to consider for your hockey player or for your team. So without further ado, let's get back to the interview with Stanley Cup champion Eric Goddard. So you come out a junior. I see your stat line there, 300 penalty minutes your last year there, and you signed as a free agent to Florida. It's crazy that we have that in common too. Our first NHL contracts were with Florida. But at what point, and maybe it wasn't junior, maybe it wasn't, I don't know, but like, did you believe in you to be like, I think I can do this at the NHL level? Like, I think I'm an NHL tough guy. Like, was there a moment for you, like, where you kind of remember, or was it more gradual, or how did that all work?
Almost no. I never really thought that, never really crossed my mind. Like, it always seemed like just some sort of like, oh, I can't believe I'm here, because I went from midget to junior all of a sudden. Then at the end of my junior year, we got beat out of playoffs. And you're like, well, you're going to go up to the American League. I'm like, what? This is, I keep thinking, like, this is the end. Like, it can't be. So, I mean, got pulled up to American League, played some games at the end of the year. I'm like, the same kind of scenario. I'm like, this is kind of happening. It's almost a little, I mean, not easier in the game, but there's a little easier thought process, or because it's like, okay, this was my role in junior. This is going to be my role there. And again, having Maxie there too, it's like, hey, you know, keep doing, just play your game and just go from there. You know, he already had me kind of like in that kind of mindset of don't get too caught up in the moment. Just go out there and just do your thing, play your game, and things will go from there.
Right. So there wasn't that one, I don't know, like in the AHL, there wasn't the one big tough guy that maybe you did well against or something and thought, holy smokes, like I belong here. Or did you feel, and that's the thing, that's the mental side for me is like, cause I know, I guess I'll relate it to me. I did really well my rookie year in the AHL. Like I had over a point a game. I think I scored 25 goals or whatever as a 20-year-old. So like, I felt like I belonged there, right? Like I sort of, it wasn't a big transition for me for whatever reason, but every time I put on that NHL jersey, for whatever reason, I don't know, I just didn't feel like I belonged there. Like I wasn't comfortable. I didn't think I was an NHL'er yet, like mentally, you know, like I think my skill set was there and everything, but I didn't think that I was really there. Did you ever have that kind of piece? I know you said like, not really, but maybe at the AHL level, like was it before, I don't know, like, did you have a moment there where you're like, oh my, I just beat this guy up. Not sure if I was supposed to be able to do that.
Well, there's one thing. I ended up, one of the guys is Todd Fedoric. He was with Philly, and he was a couple years ahead. He was getting some games with the Flyers, and because he would just run over guys, right? He was what they call him, the fridge. He was a tank. But I remember my first game was against, Philly. I saw him. And he was fighting all these guys, doing really well. You're like, holy, he's got tons of hype. I'm like, I fought this guy. I did pretty good. You know, maybe I do got like a shot at this. It was kind of, but then until it kind of happened, it was always kind of like, can I do this? You know, but it was, right. But seeing those guys kind of do it, that I played against junior against and then the minors against kind of gave me a rough idea that I could probably handle myself at that level.
Right. I remember Sean Thornton I had on as a guest a little while ago. So, you know, you must obviously know Thordy. I don't know how personally you know him or not, but he spoke pretty eloquently about that just because he was in the minors for a long time, as you know, like a long time. Yeah. And then ended up winning two cups and ended up like really having an amazing, you know, NHL career. And he fought a ton and he was never a big guy and no one thought he could be a heavyweight, but yet he kept doing well. And he started to get frustrated because he was like, I kept seeing all these guys move on, you know, and he's like, yeah. And I was never moving on. And, but he felt like he did belong because of what he was able to accomplish right at the AHL level. So he had the belief system in place. So when he got his call, he was kind of already ready to go. Maybe walk us through your first call up and what you remember from it and the game and everything else. Cause I know it's a special moment for me for sure. And I'm sure it was for you.
First game pro kind of thing.
No, well, first NHL.
There's a good NHL story. Game. My first year pro, first game pro. I'll start with this story. It's pretty funny. Cause I got called up at a junior to, it was Florida's farm team in Louisville. It was their last year in Louisville.
Yeah,
they had like Brent Thompson, Rocky Thompson, Joey Tedarenko. I think one of those like Cabana brothers. I can't remember this guy. Maybe scrappy guy. So I'm nervous as I went out there. I fought someone. I don't know if Fedoric was there or not. Might have been him. I think he was the first guy I fought in the NHL too. Just helped me up the whole way up. But we're playing, yeah, because just a goon squad, basically, the whole team. I was up there called up, and, like, I heard Rocky Thompson. You know, he's fighting. He's doing the big flexing. Like, this guy was crazy. Always heard the legends of him and Scott Parker going, because Parks played in, well, a clone in that old rink. You're like, this guy's crazy. But it was near the end of the game. We got a penalty shorthand. They gave us a face off at our defensive blue line. I'm like, oh, what's going on? They had a couple of Russian guys out there that had like no idea. They're just there to get some points. Puck drops. They had Frankie Lassard. He comes screaming at Tedarenko from the point because he was sticking one of their guys. I'm like, this is right in front of our bench. And I remember, I think it was Cabana, cut them off, and they start fighting. I'm like, oh, this is nuts. I look over down the ice. Brent Thompson is absolutely – this guy's turtled, and he's just smashing this guy. I was like, this can't be happening. I look back at Ted Arenico's fighting with a guy. Cabana's fighting with Frankie Lassard. I'm like, okay. I look back over. Rocky Thompson has nothing on. He's like – took his sweater off, his shoulder pads. He's shirtless on the ice. And he's like giving like the 1-2 because there's the two Russian PP guys like standing side by side. And he's like punching at both of them. And they're so confused. The one guy takes off his own jersey and he's standing there. I don't know how he did this because he took his own sweater off. He saw his helmet and gloves and stick in his hands and no sweater. This guy's a magician. Then I look back. Ted Arenico's fighting and they're still fighting. I look back and it's just literally heads on a swivel, like fights going on. I'm like, this is wild. Then I'm watching the Lions been trying to put Brent Thompson out the end boards because we came out the Zamboni doors and they came out that same end just in the corner. But they're pushing Brent Thompson out. Our backup goalie is like trying to hold the door and not let the guy get pushed out. He's like, I know we're going to be down 5-3 on guys in this big line brawl. So they finally get him out. He's standing behind the glass. They finally get Frank Lassard because he's a little wild man too. But they put him in the opposite corner, not to the dressing room. So he's just standing there, basically on concrete. That's why, okay, it's kind of calming down. They're breaking up fights, and I hear the crowd erupt again. And I look up on the Jumbotron, there's Brent Thompson and Frank Lassard out in the stands fighting in this runway. And it's like, you got this look, it's like WWF, the cameraman's hanging over the ledge, like filming these guys. I guess Brent Thompson like weaved his way through the stands, like underneath like those big, I don't know how he got even through there, tap Lassard on the shoulder, and they just start fighting. I'm like, this can't be real. It's my first game. I'm like, this is crazy. My next game was against like Hershey. There was like Scott Parker. And then remember Frank Bialowis?
The Animal?
The Animal was playing at Hershey too. Long hair, big beard. This Parker, big beard. And they're just like cruising the blue line. And I'm like, I don't know what to do because Brent Thompson got suspended. Rocky Thompson got – everyone suspended. It's basically – I was like, oh, shit. I'm like the only guy here. And they're like both like back and forth through the red line, just staring down. I'm like, oh, God, like I'm going to get murdered. I've heard of the Animal. I know Parks from before. I think they end up – may have got scratched or something like that. There's nothing really happened that game.
Oh, my God. You were like, thank God.
Yeah, I'm like, this is – I can't play in this. Like, this is insane. Making the next step to the NHL was kind of easy after that game. That's yeah. True.
Well, no, seriously, though. Like, it was – I don't know. It's kind of fun to tell the stories. The game is so different now, obviously. But the stories are fun because it was nuts. Like, it was absolutely nuts. It was crazy. Yeah.
Oh, it was nuts. The AHL was – that was the toughest league I've ever played in by far. Like, some of those guys. Like, Steve McLaren was a short, stocky dude, but just – I remember he hit me in the eye, and my eye, like, instantly swelled shut. It's like, I used to be, like, okay, like, not really get black eyes or anything like that. I was like, okay. Boom. I was like skating to the penalty box and it's like picture my eyes already black and like swollen up. I'm like, that took like half a second.
How do you do that? We were in the Rock actually, and Terry Ryan, I don't know if you ever played with him or you know the name or whatever, but he was a first rounder to Montreal and he played in Fredericton under Terry and Freddie had some tough teams back when I was like my first couple of years. I don't think you were in the league yet then, but, and then the baby Leafs were tough. And like that whole division was like, well, the whole league was tough. Like, let's be honest, but like that division was like exceptionally tough. And there was just nights where it was just nuts. Like Thordy said, he knew, like he was three fights for sure and out, you know, like he knew he was fighting three times. And, you know, we have stories of Greg Bird Dog Smith shooting pucks across the ice at the goalie coach and like just crazy absurd stuff that you would never think is supposed to happen unless you're watching Slapshot. But it was like on a weekly basis you would see
that was crazy. Straight it that was a Slapshot. Like you go in and there was, you're like, there's, they got like three, four guys that throw down, like you got two. It's like, okay, like if I don't fight each of these guys, like it's just gonna get out of control. Like, yeah, three fight nights were, I don't know, like more, I mean, they weren't every night, but it's like, it was felt like it was pretty regular to have like two, three fights a game.
I did look up, and one thing I found in my brief bit of research was that your first NHL fight was against my roommate in Toronto, Mr. Ty Domi. So, I don't know if you remember that or not. I assume you would, but do you remember that fight at all? And was it, there any significance there to fight, you know, I some would consider him kind of a legend in the game, you know, how long he did what he did for and the career he had. So maybe walk us through that whole scenario.
Yeah, it was crazy to be like on the ice with like some of these guys I played against were just kind of like skill guys, tough guys. You always watch it. Like this can't be real. But what happened is I got traded to the Islanders. Because we played in Bridgeport, right? Mm-hmm. And I got traded to the Islanders after that year. And that – they had that really huge series, right, with like Tucker was there, like Corson and stuff. And I think that Peck and Yash, and they got their Islanders, finally got back to the playoffs. It was had this amazing seven-game series against Toronto. I remember Pekka got hurt by Tucker or something like that. They just blew it up with this big cheap shot. I can't really quite remember it. Mm-hmm. But they're coming around the next year. There's still that.
Oh,
you there? Sorry.
No worries. Go ahead.
Back. Except you might want to fit where your head is right now because I can only see part of your.
Yeah. How's that?
There we go.
That's better, yeah.
Yeah.
You sure you want to see that?
Yeah, of course, man. You're good looking, man.
but it was, they were just totally jacked up. The Coliseum fans were nuts. Like, they're just, the vibe in that arena was just like, it's going to be a bloodbath. And do you remember Steve Webb?
Oh, yeah.
He was like a cannonball getting shot around the ice. Honestly, playing with him made my job so easy because he would be around like destroying guys, and I'd just have to basically follow the pile of wreckage behind this guy and just try and cover for him. But we're on the ice, and I just remember hearing this like thud, and I like looked over, and I think it was Hoagland. It was like probably about 6 feet in the air, completely horizontal, like out cold. He comes crashing to the ice, and I was like, oh my God, this is just melee. I think I just dropped my gloves instantly. Like,
courtesy of Webby?
Yeah, just blew him up. And then I think it was Ty that came in. We ended up crossing paths or like cut him off trying to, because he was out to basically kill Webby. Like, I think that's, talk about screws going loose. I think he lost it. I cut him off or something like that. And we ended up fighting. I was like, this and tight homie kind of thing. Got to the penalty box. I'm like, shit, this is I did okay too. I was like, hey, you know, a little pumped up, you know. I remember watching Sam, seeing his old fights and stuff like that. Like, oh, I can't believe I just fought Domi. He just kind of did all right. His huge head and his left hand coming at you, it's just steady.
Yeah. You talk about like you having a good well, I don't know what you'd even call that, but like a eyes that wouldn't go black very often or whatever from getting hit. Like I wasn't in Toronto long enough to speak like super from experience, but I did see Ty get in fights when I was there, and I did see him take a lot of shots, especially this one fight. And it was like nothing happened to him. Like I couldn't believe it. I think I kind of have an okay body for that too. Like I don't bruise very easy and stuff, but like, There wasn't a mark. There wasn't a welt. And I'm like, you just got smashed in your face, like by a large man.
Yeah, and he had
nothing there.
Nothing. I remember, I think one of the guys, I think it might have been Snow, he's like, you cut him. I've never seen him cut before. I'm like, did I cut him? Because I didn't see it at all. Maybe it was like a drop of blood or something like that. Because, yeah, nothing would happen. He'd have not a single mark. He'd be laughing. You're like, this guy's.
Yeah. How demoralized. Like, that would make you like a little, like demoralized a little bit, wouldn't it? Like, can't hurt him.
Yeah, kind of. Like, he's like, I hit this guy as hard as I can. And he's just, I'm like, I just, I feel like a small child.
Yeah. Did I ever tell you my Jim McKenzie story?
No.
Oh, I gotta tell it to you. Do you ever fight, Jim?
Yeah.
Anything memorable about those fights?
No, it was like one. It was just one preseason game. We're just kind of getting to. It was a all right.
Yeah.
Fairly even fight.
I was. I didn't know who he was, and I had just come over in a trade from Toronto. So you know how even like the league was then, right? Like the East was in the East, and you barely ever saw the West, and you know, like the way the AHL was and stuff too. Like there wasn't too many, you didn't cross paths too much with some of those Pacific teams. And I had got traded the year before, so I was in camp with the Kings and trying to make this team as fourth line, third line, right winger. They told me to come in at like 215 pounds that year, and so I was in the, you know, whatever. Drinking whole milk shakes five times a day and, you know, trying to be a power lifter in the gym, and accomplished my 215 and came into camp and was, you know, trying to play physical and stuff and play the role. Wasn't trying to become a fighter by any stretch of the imagination, but in this one preseason game, Solani got rammed through the boards by Sean O'Donnell kind of from behind, right? And you can imagine how that played out, right? Korea and Solani were both in that game. And so I think we were down a man. And so I went out for the penalty kill, and Jim McKenzie comes out for the power play. Right. And I mean, I knew enough about him that I knew he wasn't supposed to be on the power play. Right. Like it was probably his first power play minute he's had in a long time. And somebody, I forget who lined up next to him. Somebody lined up next to him who probably like should have been the guy lining up next to him. And then Andy Murray yells over to me. He's like, Padolin, you get over there. So like he made like the guy go back. I wish I remember who it was. So then I go over there, 21 years old, right? Like just scored 42 in the AHL the year before. And I'm lined up beside Jim McKenzie. And so Jim McKenzie, right when the puck drops, he slashes my ankles with two hands and he goes, "Here we go, kid." Right. I totally remember, like, playing his day. I don't remember much. So I drop my gloves and I swear, I mean, I'm not pretending I had any huge power punches or anything, but I hit him as hard as I've ever hit a human in my life. Right. Like twice, three times, man. I think I might even got three and not like nothing. Right. He's standing straight up, the grin in his face. Right. Like, and all of a sudden he starts raining down the, I had no idea he was left. Right. So then he starts throwing lefts at me. I was throwing with my right. I ate like three or four. I'm on my back. He cut me open on my cheek, right? Like, anyway, the whole thing didn't go well for me. But the beauty of that story is, one, I was fine. You know, like, I got to get stitched up. The boys absolutely loved it, you know, that I fought Jim McKenzie. And I had no idea how tough he was either. Like, I remember Lappy and LaPerriere was like, "He's like top five, man. He's top five." He kept telling me, right? He's fought Jim. Anyways, it was hilarious. So that's my one claim to fame in the tough guy department. I fought Jim McKenzie.
Yeah, he was tough. He was huge.
He was big and left. I wish I would have known that earlier, but I probably would have fought the exact same way. Maybe it wouldn't have mattered. Yeah. when it comes to like memorable scenarios, I mean, we're coming up here in an hour. I totally want to talk about, first of all, I want to give you an opportunity to talk about your goals, because as fun, we joke around, I know you well enough, but you know, I wouldn't have bet, like how you said earlier, I mean, every step for you is like, holy shit, I'm here, right? Like, wow, I'm here. And I bet you if a lot of people would have bet on who would have scored more goals in the NHL, they wouldn't have put much money on you over me, but you definitely kicked my ass in that department. So I'm going to give you your claim to fame here, and I want you to tell us about your favorite goal in the show and break it down.
It's hard to say my favorite one. I can't go – like, my first goal ever was against Toronto, Ed Balfour, you know, just everyone knows that name. But it was honestly, it got to be comical because it went off my skate and in. I think my first four or five goals like went off my skates and in. And every single one went to review. So I'm like, when my skate went in, I'm like, oh my God, try to celebrate the first goal. Everyone comes out and they're like, hey, you know, picking up the puck. I'm like, and instantly you knew like their refs are talking, it's review. Like I didn't. I'm sitting on the bench and it's, I don't know why it took so long. It felt like it took 3 hours, but it was probably like 2 minutes. Hey, it's a good goal. I'm like, oh, awesome. That's not at all how I thought.
How I wanted it to be.
Okay. And then like the second one, same kind of thing. Reviewed. Third one, reviewed. I'm like, this has got.
That is so funny, yeah. Man. That's hilarious. So for real, the first three, not four, the first four.
I swear, first four goals, all reviewed.
First four goals went to video review because it went off your skate.
Yeah. So yeah, they counted still, but.
Well, holy smokes. So you got six goals. So four of them went off your skate. I know that I saw one that you shot in. It was actually a nice, pretty nice goal. Is that the one that you're going to talk about then?
I don't even remember that one. I shot it. I can't be. What goal is that?
I don't remember that one. That's so awesome. Well, I thought you went to the net and it was something like mine. Mine was a rebound goal, like that I shot through Ron Hextall's legs. It was not, there was nothing special about it at all, just from the slot. And but it was still one that I actually used my stick for, so I guess I have that. And you shot one in for sure. I think it was a similar thing. Rebound going to the net, I think side of the net, and you hit the open side is the highlight that I remember, but maybe not. Maybe it was a preseason game or something that I saw. And
probably preseason, yeah. I had a couple that just ended up like bouncing off a stick and going in, just driving the net, hitting the stick.
Yeah, well, hey, man, you take them. You got six of them. That's pretty cool. And 833 penalty minutes to go along with it. That's a lot of fights, man. There can't be too many minors in there, I wouldn't think.
There wasn't a ton, no. Had to be very careful. You take a minor, you wouldn't play the rest of the game.
Right,
take some sort of bad penalty.
Do you know how many majors you got? Like, is that something you know?
No, not sure.
Not
so. It was the majority of those ones. Yeah,
so over 100 fights in the NHL, for sure.
Yeah, it's
that is
pretty close. Yeah,
talk, man. Let's talk about the run. Let's talk about the run. Let's talk about the cup. Let's talk about playing with one of the greatest players to ever play. and Sidney Crosby. Let's talk about one of the biggest icons, the goaltender in the sport, and Marc-Andre Fleury. Like that time and that team in Pittsburgh to be a big piece of that puzzle, man. You were on Marc-Andre Fleury's mask, man. Like you definitely made an impact on him. Talk about that whole the whole culture there. Anything you want to talk about when it comes to the Pittsburgh Penguins and that Stanley Cup you were part of?
That was, yeah, obviously number one highlight right there. Because the year before they went to and played Detroit and lost to Detroit in the final.
Game seven.
Game seven, yeah. And that was my first, so I came and signed that next year. And it was almost like instantly you could be like, okay, these guys feel like they have something to prove. Like, I didn't know anything about the year before. I remember watching on through TV and stuff like that. But there was obviously from the get-go, there was something. Definitely, it felt like a mission. Playing with Sid and Gino. God, Jordan Staal was our third line center. I mean, it was a really good team. Fleury between the pipes. Lot of talent, a lot of grit as well. Guys that you never heard of that were just could make plays, you know, whether it's just making first pass, you know, the zone or block shot, just lots of guys like that. It was just, I think we got off to a really good start. And then like any kind of year, we got hit like a huge slump. I think we ended up being like in 10th place. I just remember it was just like something just wasn't clicking. Maybe it just got like gotten a bit of a rut. The length of the season before, everyone seemed just kind of like stuck, you know, feet were in the sand or stuck in the mud. So they ended up firing the coach, who was Therrien. They brought in Bylsma, got rid of a couple of guys, and like they traded for Craig Adams. One of those fourth line guys would like stick his face in front of to block a shot, would fight anybody, and just, even though that's not kind of anything he did. Brought in Bill Guerin, he had a big impact. And once that coaching change happened, so remember Dan came into the room before the game. It was just one of those conversations that kind of resonated with everybody. He's like, listen, no matter what happens tomorrow, the newspapers and media is going to write a story. No matter what. There's a big change with the coaches. This team slumping, going from the finals to being a 10th spot out of the playoffs this year. They're going to write something. But it's up to, like, we had the opportunity to basically dictate what they were going to write, because all they're going to do is report on what happened in the game and whatnot. So it's just basically some small challenge, like that we have the ability to dictate the narrative of what this team and the rest of the year is going to be like. And I think just from the get-go, it was, you know, a team's always kind of coaching chains. They'll have that big spurt of life. Same thing happened to us. We ended up playing. I think we won that game. And we just went on this tear. And I don't know what the record was. I felt like it was probably like 22 or something like that. I forget where we ended up, what place we ended up in, like fourth or third or something. You're going to have to fact check those because I'm probably totally wrong. But yeah, just going on that run and taking that momentum into the playoffs, we just kind of were like, this is it. Like we're winning. Like there was never like a, you know, we could do this. It was just more of a different, like we're going to win. Like it, nobody cared. That was just a belief. Like we're going to win. And it was just that kind of, I mean, it's such a big mindset thing. Like you're touching about earlier and stuff like that. So much of it is mental. When you got a guy like you say, Sid, so good. Gino, so good. All these players that were just completely all in. We're going to do whatever it takes. We're ready for it. We're prepared. And take guys like that kind of talent, get them in the zone, and they're pretty tough to stop. Like, you got Sig coming out one shift, trying to match up with that line. And then you got Gino coming out, trying to match up that center. He was a monster that year too. And then Stahl comes out as a third line center, shutting guys down. They were just basically shut other teams down, score goals. And it was such a big factor in that success as well.
Right. Where does that belief come from, do you think? Like, you mentioned that word, and that's something that I try to unpack and talk about quite a bit, is, you know, and trying to develop that, you know, trying to use it. Where do you think that came from? That losing's not an option, right? Like, we're going to find a way through this because we believe that we're supposed to be at the top of the mountain when this is done.
Where we got from was almost that kind of first meeting. Like, it gave us almost like a chance to just reset, take a breath, instead of being like, holy crap, we're losing game after game. We're losing. We're not in the playoffs. Almost like a panic mode. Like, we're not in the playoffs. We're not going to win. We got so much pressure because we're supposed to be winning. This is our chance to win the cup. We made it to the finals the year before. And it was almost just that right kind of combination of being like, okay, start over. We're still this good team. We all knew it. I mean, the players we had on that team, like, there's never a doubt that we weren't like a top team. It was just maybe just one of those times where it's like, okay, reset, refocus. This is where we're at. This is where we want to go. And it's up to us. If we just simply believe that we can do it, we can let ourselves do the work for it. I mean, I guess it's not just like a I believe in myself kind of thing. It was more of, if we put in the work, we all believed that we could win.
Yeah, and you were probably, like you said, and you're getting those, you need the reset button sometimes, because sometimes you start worrying about the wrong, like, the focus goes in the wrong direction. You know, like you said it a few times, right? Oh, we're not winning. Oh, we're not in the playoffs. Oh, we're supposed to do this, right? Like, none of those thoughts are helping you guys win hockey games, right? But then you press that reset button, Dan Bylsma comes in, and I couldn't imagine a more opposing voice to Therrien. I mean, I know Dan as a player because I played with him. I saw him literally block a shot with it. You know how much he blocked shots back in the day. He blocked a shot with his face, broke his orbital bone. I saw him. He ended up playing. He played that guy was crazy anyways, but like a really amazing team guy. And I heard Therrien isn't that great of a human being, but I don't know. I never played for him. So I can imagine Dan coming in, though, even from the stories I heard, it was probably like, it was also a breath of fresh air, I'm sure, just from a culture perspective, right?
Yeah, it was definitely a change of pace. Because Therrien was that, like, kind of gritty. It's almost, I played a lot with him, so it's kind of like, well, he gave me lots of opportunities. But he was that, just one of those coaches that almost seemed to have that shelf life. You know, like, they're going to be on you, be all over you, calling you out, and just, I think after a while, and that happened with us with losing, and then just the negativity from that kind of aspect and from your coach or whatnot, guys kind of almost got to the point where, like, I can't do this again. Like, stop. No one's listening to you. You got to change. And so they brought in, like you said, Dan, blocked shots with his face, funny guy, always wanted to have a good time, but also had that, have fun doing it. But also, it's like, winning is the fun thing. Like, you put in the work, put in the effort, and we'll win. I mean, that's, I don't know, you get all kind of a role like that, I guess. Like, I mean, winning's not everything, I guess, you hear, but it's, I don't know, it's pretty fun to win.
Yeah, it totally is.
Going to take a short break here to talk about Verbero. Verbero Hockey is a company that I am affiliated with. It sells custom apparel for teams. That's one thing that is really cool about Verbero. If you need new jerseys, customized jerseys. You need custom apparel, meaning team jackets or team warmies or hoodies, any of that stuff they do. They're experts at. They have an amazing design team when it comes to the uniforms. Get your socks customized, get your jerseys customized. They do custom gloves, all at a super affordable price. They love working direct with their customers. That's what they do. That's what makes them different. I have used them before for my spring teams. If this is something that you want to use, you can reach out to me and I can get you in touch with them. That's how their business model works. They don't go to sports stores. They don't go to the big box stores. What they do is they have an online presence and they use people on the ground that represent them as ambassadors, I believe we're called is the right term. So that's how they get the word out about their product and about their business and what they do. So if you would like to order custom jerseys, if you would like to order custom apparel, if you would like to do these things, you can get a hold of me at Up My Hockey at the contact site, and I can get you everything you need to know. The one thing I will say for the hockey parents out there is their equipment, their sticks in particular, I believe are some of the best on the market. I'm talking high level, high quality, top of the line stick. It's called the Mercury 350. And I believe it's still the lightest stick on the market. 350 grams at a price point that is well underneath the recognized, more recognizable brands in the competition, like the Trigger 6 Pros and the Bauer Shifts or whatever they're called now. You know, you name those top of the line sticks, the Vibero 350 is right there. It comes in an all blackout model. I think it looks super sharp. I've used it. I've had my junior, meaning my youth players, use it. I have my 09s in a 55 flex. My 2012 is in a 35 flex. They also go down to 25 and 15. They have the regular curve patterns that you'd expect to see. And yeah, at a price point that you just can't beat. And they last. They are durable. They are high performance. They don't break. Knock on wood. I haven't had an issue with any of them breaking. We've been through almost 10 now from people growing and changing flex patterns and all that. We've been using them for almost 2 years. And I myself have used a 75 and an 85. Love them both. So that is a great place. And if you want to get them, verbero.com or verbero.ca/Podolan, P-O-D-O-L-L-A-N, is the way to do that. And you'll get 5% off by using that discount code, which is Podolan. It also recognizes me as being the person that introduced you to the brand. So if you're looking to save money, but you still want a great product, I'm telling you, they ship it right to your door. Give it a try. I would not be saying this if I didn't believe in the product. The sticks. I have not used the elbow pads or the pants or the skates. Like, there's lots of things that I have not used, but we have used. I have first person experience with the sticks, and I'm a big supporter of those. And I know how hard they are to get and how expensive they are. So trying to save you parents out there a few dollars, that is something that you might want to consider. So that's it. Verbero.com. Like I said, the discount code is Podolan. And if you have any questions or have any team question inquiries, get a hold of me at upmyhockey.com in the contact now. Thank you so much. Now back to the interview with Eric Goddard. Makes a lot of things go away. We had that good run in Bridgeport too, right? Like, that was, I mean, and we didn't win that year, but like, I've had that discussion on here too, is like, there's something special about those teams even to go that far, right? Yes, we didn't get to raise that trophy, but to get to the final, you got to do a lot of things right.
Yeah.
You know, and you got to have a tight team to get there. And yeah, I mean, we fell one short, but like, totally, like, super memorable year. Like, the bonds that we had together, how tight that team was and what we went through. And I can imagine how galvanizing that was for Pittsburgh that year before. Like you said, you weren't there to be a part of it, but to get that close, right? To get that close and to experience what they experienced together and to not be able to lift that trophy, that had to have built a little of that belief internally. And then again, you get on that roll, you get a fresh voice, you found some positivity and things start rolling and you know, something special happens and you were able to be a part of that something special. What's your favorite Sidney Crosby story, if you have one, and I don't know which way you want to go. It could be something funny, because like, he's known as being a pretty serious guy. It could be something just to galvanize what everybody thinks of him already, which is this guy that's like such a
you know, just always wants to get better and you know, has that professional approach or whichever way you want to go. But I think it would be silly not to ask you something about him.
Yeah, I don't know. Stories that I, like we were talking earlier, my memory is kind of tough. It's like get these things brought up and they come flashing back. But yeah, to play with that guy and saw like the, I don't know, some of the, like the superstitions and stuff like that the guy had. I mean, but I think those superstitions go back to just how someone prepares for a game. Well, it's like so weird, but it's like, well, I'll just do this because it makes me feel good in the game. I mean, that's kind of it, but
Well, I know about his jock. Like, is that kind of, I heard he had the same jock from like Adam or something, or from Bantam. Like it's been re-sewn like a 500 times or something. Like, is that a true story?
I don't even know if it's re-sewn. Cause I don't know. You see this guy, like, I think he's actually dropped some weight since the game's kind of changed. It doesn't have to be as, but his legs and his ass were like enormous. Like just the strength this guy had with this, it was enormous, but he had this jaw. It's been restitched and re-sewn. Like the thing was, like, that's all he did. He wouldn't replace any elastic or anything like that. So it was just this pitch, huge, long piece of fabric. There's no stretch. It's not tightening back up. So it basically just sits on there. Oh, he almost had to do like squats and workout just to keep the thing up. But it would just hang on in there. I don't even know how it stayed. It never stayed in place. It couldn't have.
So that wasn't true.
Oh yeah, the thing's enormous.
That's funny.
It's like trying to put on a hula hoop with a cup on it.
Oh my god. Well, one, maybe this will ring, and maybe you can add to this, because David Quinn I had on as the Rangers coach, and he said he just brought it up. He had a colleague that was at the NHL awards banquet in Las Vegas, and it was the year that Sid was like 22 or something. I know you didn't play with him at that point, but early in his career, and it was when he won his first Hart Trophy. So he just won the night before, right, the Hart Trophy for the best player in the world. And this guy was leaving for his flight at 6 a.m. to go back. Like that was, he was assistant coach for some team, and he's leaving the hotel, and he walks past the weight room, and Sidney Crosby was working out at 6 a.m. in Vegas the night after he won the Hart Trophy. And I mean, my God, I mean, you don't have to make too much of a, to be like, are you kidding me? Like in Vegas, like you didn't go out for a few drinks, Sid, and like maybe want to sleep in, but like he's actually trying to get better for the next year. Like, is that pretty prototypical of what his approach was like?
I'd say so. Yeah. Like he was obviously, the guy has enormous amounts of talent. His hockey IQ is amazing. I mean, I'm probably sure there's other guys out there that are good, but just didn't have the same kind of mental focus or drive to be the same way. But yeah, he would do like work like that. He would, I don't know, student of the game. He'd be like, we'd be leaving practice sometimes. He's still in there trying to tweak a stick or something like that, just to get ready for the next night. He's just hanging out at the rink. Just loved being there, shooting pucks.
Yeah.
But he was definitely, he is like on him. I don't know. I shouldn't say on him, but he's constantly wants to get better. He wants to, I don't think he had any grudges towards people, but he like wants to make sure everyone knows that he's going to be the hardest working guy out there. It's just me. I mean, you still see it now, like how he approaches the game. I mean, I felt like you could put anybody on his line. He's going to make him better and turn him into like 40 goal scorers.
Yeah.
But he is, yeah, he's definitely a special guy, special talent. Like he loves having fun too, but he's like, when it comes to work, he's putting in the work.
Yeah. Yeah. And he said always, I mean, I think you said there, he always wants to get better. And I heard that he's always working on his game. And that's the one thing that I mean, for the message, why I like talking about that is because the message is very similar, like what the message was with Kobe Bryant, or what the message is for, you know, Michael Jordan's was, is like these young kids see these guys on TV and they see how awesome they are and they see their highlight reel goals and all the points that they get and stuff. And I think they don't really understand that they're working harder than those kids have ever worked ever in their life at something that they're the best in the world at. You know what I mean? Like, I think they think it's just happening for them. They're just better, right? They're just the best. But like Sydney, at the best in the world, is in the gym at 6 a.m. in Vegas when everyone else is drinking beers, right? And he's working on his game after practice, and he's in the weight room doing whatever. Like, it's not an accident for these guys. And I think that's the thing that I like about Sydney, maybe more so than Mario, who was my idol, because Mario seemed to be one of those guys that was like just really natural. You know, like really natural. And although Sid was a phenom from a young age, he worked his ass off from what I heard, and still does, to be at the shape that he's in. So thanks for sharing those stories. I just like having that out there, right? Because we do have this idea of these guys that they're just way better. You know,
so good. They just kind of there's nothing I can do about it, right? They're just so much good. And, you know, it's like, if I could shoot like that or put in, I'd be the same kind of thing. It's like, well, no, like I said, like COVID, there's a reason those guys get separated, because of they work with the talent they have.
Yeah, and they get the most out of it. I know your buddy still. I think you're still buddies. The last time I talked to you, you were with Marc-Andre Fleury, who is one of the biggest personalities in the game, and it seems like everywhere he goes, I mean, he won a Vezina 2 years ago, like, didn't he? Like at 30, yeah. Whatever, six, like insane. Had another good season this year. It seems like every team he goes on, he makes better. Just like Sid, you said, with his line mates. I mean, what a testament to a player to say, yeah, you make everyone else around you better. What makes Marc-Andre special, and why does he have such a lasting impression on the league?
I don't know. Everyone talks about like how good of a guy he is and stuff like that. He's always, I don't know. He's just like a character. He's always fun loving. He's always making guys laugh, making feel guys at ease. What makes him? Sorry, what were you asking there?
Well, it's like how he has this. Like, he seems to have this effect, right? Like where he goes. I mean, people want to play for him. It seems like he makes the locker room better. He makes guys better around him. I'm just wondering about his, like, what about his personality or his work ethic or his approach? Like, has that impact on a team?
Yeah, his work ethic too is crazy. You know, he's one of those guys talented that works. I mean, it's kind of almost like a simple story in that way. But guys want to play hard in front of him because he puts in an effort. But at the same time, he's always making guys laugh. And sometimes you see the goalies, they just don't, like, they kind of off to themselves. They're not like goofing around in front of, I don't know, I think he's going up for warm-ups or something like that. Or after warm-ups, going up for the game, he's doing cartwheels in his gear. You're just like, what? Just laughing, you know? He's like, you go and scoot, he'd just chirp you if you scored on him, you know? Or he makes a big save and he's just laughing at you, throwing it in your face. But he's just, I don't know, one of those is a fun guy. It's like the teammate that you want to help win because you see him doing so well. And also, you go back to that run for us too. It's like, maybe we weren't as scared. We're like, okay, he's going to stop this one for us. You know, when you have the confidence to have just a good goalie, you just play better.
Yeah.
And with his kind of outgoing personality, it's just kind of almost took like the edge off. But he's a good guy. It's almost to a point where it's kind of, because he's had a weird last few years. It's almost, God, it's like frustrating for me knowing the guy. Like I say, he wins the Vezina, he gets dealt Chicago for nothing. Then he's like out of Chicago. Now he's in Mini. It's awesome. Like, guys love him there too.
Yeah.
So it's cool to see him there again. But just the level of talent and stuff like that, sometimes I almost think it's forgotten because, like, oh, he's such a good guy, you know, he's such a team guy, and you're like, well, if you can just put that aside, he is an amazing goalie. Like I said, winning Vezina's at, what was it, 36, like, competitive his whole life.
Yeah, one first overall. I mean that's pretty rare for a tender too. I love that though, like, as far as that aspect is concerned, like, not to downplay his skill level or his stats or anything else, his accomplishments, but to play that long and to play well and get results, I think that is sometimes the missing piece for goalies, because there is something a little bit different about goalies. I know everyone says goalies weird, goalies or whatever, but like, they're legitimately playing a different game than everybody else. They're the only ones to wear that equipment. They're the only ones that have to do what they have to do. Like, it's a completely different game for them. And a lot of times it attracts a different type of personality to, that's able to do that. And they get left alone. Sometimes they want to be left alone. But the odd time, you'll have a guy like Marc-Andre Fleury, or I think like Jack Campbell. Not that they're the same personality, but like Jack Campbell was a guy in Toronto that those guys wanted, like they really wanted to play for him. Like they loved him. Right. Yeah. And when you love your tender, like I do think you get more out of your team because you really want him to do well. And I think that shouldn't be understated either for the young goalies listening. Is like, whatever that is, whatever you are, be you. But really invest in your teammates. Like, I loved a goalie that would be like pat me on the back on the pads, or like thanking me for a big goal, or a guy that would tap his defenseman for blocking a shot. Like, that kind of stuff goes a long way, right? Like, guys care about that, and that's, I think Marc-Andre does a great job of that.
Oh, he's amazing. He's the best one. Yeah, like your point. Like, he's the best goalie for that I've ever played with. But yeah, completely agree with what you say. Like, you want to play for those guys. So I'm sure you ran into some of those goalies that were just, you couldn't talk to them before the game or anything. You touch their gear, they'd lose your mind. You're like you just, after a while, you're like, just shut your mouth in. Like,
yeah.
Oh, you got scored on. That's tough. You know, like, I don't care. You're such a dick.
Right. Yeah. No, I hear you. I totally hear you. It can be a little bit much at times because it's a team thing. And again, like I said, personalities are personalities, and you can't change a ton of who you are, but you can totally celebrate and amplify different portions, right? And turn down others. And I think the guys that, the goalies, and to put you to your point though, because I don't want to forget about this, goalies that make it fun in practice because they're so damn competitive. Like, they're so competitive. They don't want you to score in practice, and they make that aspect fun. Like, oh my gosh, they can supply so much intensity to a practice. Whereas the guy that just stands there and doesn't move, and you've had that guy before too.
Oh yeah. It gets like, mad at you because you're not shooting downer that. Oh, it's terrible.
Awful, right? It's just
terrible.
Yeah. It's so bad. And so anyways, to young goalies out there, like a massive big part of the, I mean, Brian Sutter said it best, I think, or Daryl, he said, I'll show you a great coach when you show me a great goalie. Right, like they're a huge piece of the team, right? Like, you're not going to win without a good goalie. But no. I mean, you have such an impact to practice. You have such an impact to like the culture around there. That is something that I would totally. I mean, as a scout, we haven't even talked about that, Godard. We got to talk about that. But as a scout, that's what I would be watching. Yes, I want somebody that can stop the puck, but I want to see what that guy is like with his team, and I want to watch him practice for sure. For me, a goalie, I want to see a goalie practice before I'd even consider listing him or drafting him, because I think that position is so important for the whole core of your team and what it's about.
Yeah, 100%. You can't win if you can't stop the puck. Well, yeah, definitely trying to scout and watch those guys. I can't tell you like what I know. I heard a good saying that somebody had. You're like, well, he looks like a goalie. Guy's having a good game or not. You're like, well, he looks like a goalie. You tell like the guy who's scouting goalies, yeah, go. I think this guy's good. Go watch him, and then they can break down his, I don't know, demeanor or form or how the guy sees angles and stuff like that. But so I watched one. He's like, oh, he made some good saves. Like, this guy looks pretty good. And I don't know, just pass the buck, pass it on to the next guy.
Right.
Who knows a little more.
Yeah. Well, fair enough. I mean, I talked to Dave Oliver about that too, because it's like, I don't think it's fair for, like, you are scouting a different position, right? And one that you're totally not familiar with. So it's really hard for somebody, I think, to feel comfortable in scouting a goalie who has never really been one or knows what that is. Like, most coaches, even, especially at the minor league level, like, they judge a goalie by how many pucks they you stop the puck. And I like him, you know? Like, I really like him. He does a good job stopping the puck, but there's different ways to get to that end. So, but let's talk about that. So, you mean, you've been out of the game, and I don't want to make this run on too long, and there's way more we could talk about with your career, but now you're still in hockey. Now you're working with the Minnesota Wild in the scouting capacity. Let us know what circuit you're on and what you're responsible for.
I'm just like, I guess my title is regional amateur scout. So I'll watch the Western League and the BCHL and a bit in the Alberta League, junior league. So I get to be back in the game. I started last December, January, so it's still quite a lot to learn and quite a bit to trying last year was learning on the fly. Guys have been great. Be like, just try and go as many games as you can and try and take notes on who you think's good and who's playing well. But yeah, was out of the game for quite a while. And instantly, once I kind of got this chance, how great it feels. Like, I'm loving it. I feel like back in the game. I mean, there's all the different regional guys from Ontario and the Quebec down in the States. That it just feels to be back part of a team, you know? Guys will text back and forth and thoughts. And I can call these guys or even just text them for, like, simple advice and questions. And they've just been amazing to be back in that kind of environment and kind of team wanting to be successful in this kind of scouting these players and hopefully get some good ones.
That's fantastic. That's super cool. So, like, it sounds like, well, one, you're back in an arena, sort of back to your roots, right? Like, back to what you know and what you have known forever. But the real connection point sounds like the fact that you're part of a team again, your own team, correct?
Yeah, definitely. But yeah, I feel like, I don't know, playing for so long, like since we're kids, it's like, what did someone say to me? He's like, we're hockey players. That was out of the game too. We're hockey players. This is what we do. We play hockey. We watch hockey. And it's just something that, yeah, once I got back into kind of the rinks and stuff like that and watching players, it just felt, not that I'm any good at it anymore, that there's so much more work to be done, but it was just, okay, like, I want to be here. Like, I want to do this this job for as long as I can. Hopefully I don't get fired. But
you know what, man? Like, it's so, as you say that, and like, that's kind of your epiphany is like, you're back, right? You're back part of this team. And it just hit me, like, this podcast for me has been that. Like, I've been in the game, like, with my kids and stuff, so I've been connected to hockey. But what I really love about doing this is that it's connecting me with old teammates. And it's not like everyone that's been a guest on this is now, like, part of this big team. But it's allowed me to have that. I revisit it once a week. I get to revisit it, right? Yeah. In an hour interview of telling the old stories and connecting with you and being one of the boys again. And I always leave these conversations, like, jacked up, you know, like I feel good, like the day's better because I've connected. And yeah, I mean, I think that's a pretty powerful thing to say, because it sounds like you're being able to connect again, right? Like, you're being able to connect with hockey guys about things that you guys care about and can connect with, and there's something that feels good about that.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, just coming back to, like, I got away from the game for so long, I almost would talk about some of these stories. Sorry to go back to just what you said, like, I always feel like, I feel pumped up talking to, like, remembering all these stories, you telling these stories, and I'm like, oh, I totally forgot about that. Just a smile, such a great feeling. Yeah. I got away from hockey, like, for too long where I was like, that's not a big deal. You know, it's like, now it's like, I'm back involved in, like, a organization, a team. And every time I see those guys too, it's like, I get pumped up. I'm excited, you know, going on the road again, getting to watch these games, get to have a role again in a team. It's such a, I don't know, such a great feeling. Yeah. Like, excited every time I get to see you guys.
You said you started at Christmas time. I want to talk a little bit about, like, the players, you know, whatever that you like or what you're looking for, because that's exactly what, like, my audience is listening to. These are guys that want to get noticed at the junior level or at the NHL level. You know, they want to be able to separate themselves, that they don't necessarily know to do it. So I want to ask you about that. But from a practical standpoint, so you're getting your feet wet last year. You're in there from Christmas time on. There's been an NHL draft since then. Did you have a say at the table, or did one of your guys get picked at this point? Do you have a dog in the race right now?
I don't know. There's a couple guys from out west that got picked. And it's cool to see. There's another guy that does it out west. His name's Pat Baum. He lives in Saskatoon, and he's been doing it a long time. Like, so it's great to talk to him, get advice from him. I think they lean more heavily upon his advice, because he's tried and trusted. I just tried to pitch in where I could.
Sure. Who'd you guys draft?
From out west?
Yeah.
There's a kid played in the Okotoks last year, is Rieger Lorenz, and he's going to the University of Denver this year. And what's his name? Mikey Milne, for I played with the Winnipeg Ice last year, which is he was 19, so not his draft year, but 2 years past his draft year.
So you signed him as a free agent?
No, drafted him.
Oh, okay. So second year,
which is third year.
Are you eligible for 3 years now?
Yeah, you can get. Since I think you, next year he would have just turned into a free agent, but this year, but that's one of the things the guys are liking. You talk about guys, what kind of traits they work on. I mean, the guy's a skilled player. Obviously, can put up some points. What I've kind of learned is like. You can have like an IQ and a hockey sense. You can't really kind of teach that, I guess. I mean, and one of our kind of big things is character and compete. How's this guy showing up each game? Is he working? Talk to their coaches and stuff like this. This guy compete in practice, you know, watch him in practice. What kind of character did this guy got? Is he going to be, get some, maybe should have been a penalty, but does he get up staring at, yelling at the ref and doing this like slow little trot back to the bench? It's like, that's not really good character, kind of. Well, you know, the guys that are just kind of, that you don't want to play with. You're like, just, I don't know, that goes a long way, I guess, in what I'm saying in guys' eyes.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned a few times, there's a, especially at the WHL, I mean, any level. WHL level, the funnel gets a little bit tighter. You know, AHL, it's a little bit tighter again. But my point being is that there's a lot of guys that can play hockey, right? Yeah. Like there's a lot of guys with good skill. There's a lot of guys that can play. And you're pointing to an intangible that, like, is now one of these separators, right? Because there is a lot of options. You sit there, you watch kids all year long, right? Like, all year long that can play the game. And you're looking for that difference maker that's going to allow them to take that next step and be an NHL player. And, and character comes up time and time again. And you mean how guys describe it is different. You know, the description of character is different. But people see it sometimes and they understand it. And so obviously you liked what you saw here with Rieger or with Milne when you had eyes on him last year.
Yeah, I just try and like write reports on him and try and talk about what I like about their game. And I guess you'll try and do interviews and stuff like that. That's still not a very kind of awkward zone for me trying to start a conversation with these kids. But yeah, just see kind of how they carry themselves. Are they going to put in the work? How do they play from when the games are tough? How are they going to play when things aren't going their way? Are they going to work? Are they going to shut down? Like the one kid, Lorenz, like he's one of the top player on the team, obviously. Kind of carried the team to where they got to. Obviously a target, guys trying to take cheap shots. Maybe stays down, but you saw something in him that he wants to be the guy to score the goal to whatever, kind of stick it back to the other team. You know, he's not getting outside of his mind and going to take another bad retaliatory penalty. He's just going to, okay, you want to do this to me? I'm just going to score and we're going to win the game. I'm going to beat you. That's kind of a cool thing to kind of pick up on. That I noticed about him that I liked.
I love what you just said there. What I'd like to try and do is to give players actionable descriptions of what that looks like. Like how did that look to you? Like what did you see him do that told you that this is the way this guy thought?
So we got a what happened to the play? Got a good whack on his wrist or whatever. And, but then you see like the other teams just kind of always talking to him. You saw that throughout the game and stuff like that, and he's just not reacting. But there's something about that next shift where he was his pace picked up just a little bit. It's obviously at a high skill and can skate, but something about it just was noticeably different. Like he was demanding the puck. He was moving it with a purpose to make sure and being like, hey, you're giving that puck back to me. Like I'm scoring this goal. There's just something about that you can notice, you know, you'd be around hockey. You're like, okay, this guy's got a, there's something else going on this shift. There's something else going on this game.
That's fantastic. That's yeah. Cause there's a lot of ways to respond, right? There's a lot of ways that could have looked like. He could have been pouty. He could have been chirping. He could have been taking a cheap shot, but like his response to that was one that you deemed a positive one and told you something about what's inside of him. That made him draftable and separated him. I love that. I mean, I love that kind of stuff. And that's the stuff too, like for you, everyone listening and the parents out there, it's usually the shitty stuff that happens that the scouts are really now tuning into. The score is 6-0. What's he doing? He just gave up. He made a terrible turnover. What's he going to do next? Right? Like, it's not that you can't make the turnover, but it's like you're now seeing this window into this kid's personality type, right, of how he's going to respond. And that's the thing I think that the players miss is like, you know, like the old saying, Gotti, what do you do when no one's watching? Sometimes players think there's no one watching in that moment, or they're not watching that thing, but that's exactly what I think a scout is watching. Like that's when you're watching the most, you know, when the chips are down, what are you going to do? So I love that you're bringing that up because we practice that on a daily basis, I think. Right? Like you can't turn it on in a game. I think, and that's why people think it's like true character or it's not true character, but I do think you can work on character, but you have to approach it like that. Like, you know, whatever, whether it's like a candy wrapper that's sitting by the garbage can, do you walk by it or do you pick it up and put it in the can? You know, like there's little micro examples of that all throughout your day where you can kind of do the right thing or you don't. And I think it shows up in those moments on the ice for these guys when, you know, it might not be the natural right thing for them. So they don't do it.
No, yeah, it's basically, and then you go look at parts of the game where you call guys great leaders. They start to hold everybody more accountable, whereas you might have walked past that piece of trash before and just, oh, whatever. And then you walk in with your buddy. He's like, hey, like, what are you doing? Like, pick that up. It's not right. And it's just then that will be like a learning moment for that guy. Or maybe he doesn't learn from it. And then it's like, well, that might have been your one shot.
It's crazy the whole often guys will learn from it, though.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's so powerful. And that's why I think the environment, which is why I love what I do and like just in that coaching element, whether it's coaching young men or whether it's like my private clients, but like we can't sometimes I think scouts, and I know you're new at it, but like there's this assumption that they just like, oh, they don't have it. They're not there. Right. But it's like maybe they haven't been given the choice to be able to make the right decision, you know, like. Maybe they're not really lazy. Maybe they just haven't been exposed to what really hard work looks like. You know, like maybe, right? So I'm always the guy that's asking the maybe and trying to overturn these stones for these players so they can start connecting the dots and being like, oh, okay, I can make a different decision in this moment, right? Because before that option wasn't there for them maybe, right? Anyways, and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, right? Sometimes players get it and sometimes they don't, but there definitely is scenarios where I do see big changes in guys and they can start making different choices and it just becomes who they are, which is super fun. But I'm glad that you're doing what you do now. I'm glad you're pumped doing what you're doing. I'm going to be calling your phone too now, and cause I'm spending more time in rinks. So maybe we can get to a couple games together and we can hot stove what we're looking at. And
that'd be great. Yeah.
Yeah. I love that stuff. So Godzi, it's been 90 minutes. I told you 60. So I'm going to let you go. I know you could probably keep going here for a long time, but super fun reminiscing with an old teammate. And I have thank you, but I'll thank you again. Thanks for inviting me and my family over to your house there for that Stanley Cup party. It's still one of the Hudson, like, loves that picture now, you know, like him sleeping in the cup as a 6-week-old baby. So super great memories from that day. And to be a part of that big win with you is very grateful for that. So thanks so much for being here. And thanks so much for that moment.
No problem. Yep.
Awesome.
Thanks for having me.
No worries. We'll maybe get you on at the end of the year here when you have another year under your belt and we can talk more about scouting and you know what that is for players and just sort of break down the, you know, what it is that you're looking for. Because that's a whole episode unto itself. I really think, you know, and what NHL teams want and how different organizations have different mandates, you know, and you could speak about Minnesota and what they're doing. I know Billy Guerin sets the director there, but anyways, I'm getting off another tangent. So we'll leave it alone. Thanks so much for joining us here today. And till next time, you keep doing what you're doing, and we'll see you on the flip side.
All right. Take care.
All right, man. Well, that was.
Thank you so much for listening to the entire episode, all 90 minutes. You are an Up My Hockey all-star. But I'm sure you're glad you stayed too, because I thought that that conversation really picked up at the end. I mean, for me, real special moment was hearing Eric, you know, light up about what he's doing now, and seeing him just be authentically grateful for the place he's in. The fact that he's reconnected it with a team environment at the NHL level, watching hockey, something that he loves. That to me just, it made me feel good. And those conversations, obviously anytime we can walk away from something with a fresh perspective, or something that reminds us of our own gratitude, right? And our own situation in life, that maybe things we have overlooked, like me with this podcast, you know, that as much work goes into this thing that, you know, you listeners don't see, like the cutting and the editing and the production of it, and the help that I require from my wife that I am grateful for, but that has ended up in a few disagreements here and there, and and the editing and then the putting on. I mean, there's a lot, right, that goes into this. I love the conversations. I authentically love having the conversations. It makes me feel good, and it's something that sometimes I overlook. And I didn't really know why it made me feel good, but there's never a conversation that goes by that I am not on a high for the rest of the day, that goes over into the next day and over into the next day. It is definitely an uplifting point of my week, and the fact that I get to share them with you is a super added bonus, and the fact that there is value sometimes, hopefully all the time, in the conversations and lessons for you as listeners, that also makes me feel good. So I'm grateful for Eric to mentioning that and allowing me to reconnect to this podcast and why it is that I do it, the true nature of why I do it. And obviously all the stories and all the laughs and all the reflections that we were able to share there together, Eric and I, over the past 90 minutes. And, you know, after the conversation was done, he sent me a text and, you know, just saying how much he appreciated the conversation. And it's really good to do that. So I think sometimes, and I can't speak for women, I'm sure it's probably the same, although you seem to be a bit more social creatures than us guys, at least us guys from the hockey world. I think that we don't have enough conversations. I think that we find ourselves keeping to ourselves a little too often, not reaching out and just talking just for the sake of talking and for telling a good story. I know that I'm a bit of an introvert myself, and I think it's just a really good reminder that being a part of something, being a part of a team, being able to talk, being able to share just for the sake of doing it is great for the soul. It's great for the heart. It's great for our mental health. And I think that these podcasts in some weird way kind of serve that purpose, that the conversations that perhaps I have, I hope that they feel like they're conversations that you're involved in as well. I definitely try and keep them conversational and social on that level. So hopefully what was working for me here is also working for you on the other side there. And I definitely do encourage you guys out there to reach out and to make that phone call that maybe you haven't made in a while, and to connect with somebody that you know you should be talking to, because I think those connections matter. I think they're good on a lot of levels, not just even the mental health level, but just on the social connection, networking, human level. So yeah, that's my takeaways from all the great things we talked about. I think this turned out to me to be a real human episode, and something that I'm very happy to share with you guys, and I hope it impacted you in the same way it impacted me. So till next time, play hard and keep your head up. Whoa, just watch me.